All right, thank you all for coming. My name is Tasos, I'm with RF Elements, and today we'll be doing a vendor update, right? So we'll talk about kind of, you know, what we've been doing, what makes our products great, and then we'll do some product overviews, some new products that we have coming to market. We'll do some announcements here and go through all those different things. So a few years ago, we did kind of a survey and we went out there and did some digging into, you know, what's really the biggest problems for WISPs today. And the thing that was really interesting was, you know, number one was lack of spectrum, right? That's one of the biggest issues that WISPs face today. And the next biggest issue was, you know, the RF noise, right? And interference that you have within that spectrum you're supposed to be able to use. And then finally, on top of that, if you look at the growing demand for throughput, when we looked at these three main top three issues for WISPs, we realized that it really had to do with all of the same issue. It really had to do with RF noise, pollution. So really those top three things are really just one big problem for WISPs. And you know, this RF pollution, as we call it, that's happening is happening because there's an endless amount of poorly designed antennas and hardware that's just being, you know, deployed in the field in a really unsustainable way. It's happening too fast. And really noise is just the result of a signal, right? That's not the intended signal you want to hear, right? So anything that's not your intended signal is considered noise to your radio. So in the challenge, you know, to deal with this lack of spectrum, you know, lots of new standards have come about. We have more complex radios, right? We have more complex modulation rates. You know, vendors are putting in like GPS sync, TDMA, active filtering, and really all of these things to deal with noise. But really the results of all that functionality and all that technology is not sufficient to deal with the noise issue. So at RF Elements, we decided to really set a new industry standard, right? To create antennas that have noise rejecting properties, right? To create a connection interface between the radio and the antenna that has zero or near zero loss, and really to build a solution that's scaled to give you the massive scalability that you need as a WISP today to survive in this market. So if we look at noise generation, this is kind of the antennas that are most commonly used in the industry. So if you look at the top left, that's a kind of standard 90 degree traditional sector patch array, right? So you can see that this antenna clearly doesn't radiate in only 90 degrees, right? So it's almost an omni, it leaks out the back. All the side lobes create a lot of noise and a lot of issues. So after that, you see below that one, you see that same type of 90 degree sector with a shielding kit, which was supposed to, you know, fix these problems for WISP. And you can see again, you know, it helps a little bit with co-location, but really it just changes the forward facing properties of that antenna pattern to begin with, right? So it creates all sorts of different things. If you look at the top right, this is a more narrow sector that some of the, again, industry leaders or supposed industry leaders have put out there on the market. And you can see, again, by highly manipulating, you know, an old technology to try and make it do new things, you create all sorts of other problems. And the same thing happens again with parabolic dish antennas. So it's an old technology that hasn't been updated for the demand that you as WISPs have and what the radios really require to perform to their highest level. So this is really what noise rejection looks like. These are perfect RF patterns with absolutely zero side lobes. And you can see it's very highly concentrated and very precise beam angle. So you have superior control over the radiation that comes out of your radio and your antenna system. So it's a night and day difference when you look at how antennas from yesterday used to work and what our antenna systems bring to you today. It's a big difference. Yeah. So if we look at, again, noise rejection, this is kind of the coverage area of a traditional sector. So you can see via its side lobes and the areas of the antenna that radiate way past its subscribed beam angle, this is really where you get a lot of the noise that comes into antennas. Where with a horn antenna, again, it's a very precise radiation angle, so you limit the amount of noise. And because of the very precise beams, you can co-locate them next to each other to really create high density installations to really increase not just the throughput of the individual radio, but really the total aggregate throughput that you can deliver from your tower site, which is really important. The zero loss system is something that, again, we kind of brought to the industry about 5 years ago, where we said, you know, really the coaxial connectors that we're using to interface radios to the antenna is really a huge problem, right? So, you know, we really need to, as an industry, look at a different methodology. Again, the radios today are very complex and they require very efficient transmission mediums. And really the waveguide is the perfect type of interface for today's radios and these higher frequencies and higher modulation rates. Really, when you combine all of these concepts together is really where you get this massive scalability. Because again, you know, as long as you're deploying your traditional sectors where you have, again, lots of side lobes, you get a lot of contention between your access points and even your towers, because you really create these regions of, again, unusable spectrum and unusable signal, where you really have to be able to eliminate that and have superior control over the radiation angles from your antennas. So again, with horn antennas and their very precise radiation angles, you get this massive scalability that's really necessary, again, in this industry. So back in, again, 2014, October 2014, you know, we really did change the industry paradigm, right? The industry has been kind of going the same way with the same type of antenna technology for a very long time now. And really, you know, this kind of really changed the way everything works. You know, before RF elements, everybody was, you know, all the antenna manufacturers were making the same type of antenna, you know, cheaper and cheaper, you know, just slightly changing the form factor. And on top of that, you know, you had to spend money. You had to spend money to put shielding kits on it, right? So you have to at some point ask yourself, if I'm buying an antenna that requires a shield kit in order to work properly, you should probably consider using another antenna, right? Now with RF elements, again, it's very clear. The antennas are pure, you install them, and they work as they're supposed to work, right? You don't need any other add-on products in order to make them operate properly. So this is a huge shift in the network. So really, again, if we look at the new performance level of what these competing sectors, how they work with their side lobes and everything compared to, you know, our symmetrical horns, again, it's a big difference overnight, you know. Years ago, before we came around, you know, the biggest issue for a WISP was what you see on the left, lack of spectrum, lots of noise, right? And today, now, unfortunately, our biggest issue is, you know, we have stainless steel bolts that seize up in the mount every now and then, right? And we have a problem. So again, it's a huge shift if you consider what your problems were before with the antenna solutions you were using and what they, you know, are now with our antenna solutions. It's a huge step. It's a huge step. So we consider that a very big win, right? Also at RF Elements, we like to look at the big picture, right? It's not just about creating a good product that we hope everybody buys, but it's really, you know, we take it upon ourselves to really be a responsible vendor, to do the right thing, not only for you, the customers, but also for the industry as a whole, right? So at RF Elements, we build awareness, right, for a lot of different things. We've created a brand new vocabulary for this industry, so to speak. I mean, these terms that people never used to talk about, side lobes, nobody ever talked about them. They're always within the spec sheets and the polar plots of the antennas you bought, but no manufacturer ever told you, hey, these things are bad, you know? We do a lot to try and educate the industry and educate our customer base. I mean, for those of you who know me and heard me speak before, you know, a lot of times it's like, yeah, of course we want you to buy our antennas, but really my goal is to make sure you know how to buy a proper antenna, right? And that's really the key and what sets us apart from a lot of vendors. So we just happen, you know, to be lucky that we make some of the best antennas at the moment. So, but the key here is really to be able to teach you how to notice the difference between something good and something bad. We really, you know, it's kind of in our DNA, in our core, to really protect the spectrum that we have, right? I mean, it's really important. You know, I tell people all the time, I mean, we're really lucky here in the US that we have this whole 5 gig spectrum, right? And everybody's always looking for the next band. We want the 3 gig, LTE, all this other stuff. It's like, we keep forgetting about this gold mine we have in the 5 gigahertz spectrum, right? If we use it properly, if we use antennas, right, that are well made and have, you know, high precision to them, you have all the spectrum you need, right? You have all the spectrum you need. So let's take a little bit of time and make 5 gigahertz great again before we start going out and looking, because what will end up happening is we'll do exactly to this new band, whatever we may get, what we did before if we don't learn how to use spectrum properly. So again, we try and do the right thing for the industry. We really do. We really care about that. So when I say do the right thing, it's truly our goal, because we have this a lot of disagreements sometimes with customers. You know, our goal as a responsible vendor is really not to fulfill your wishes for the products that you want. It's really, our goal is to solve the problems with a proper product, right? You know, people are always asking for, we want dual band omnis, or, you know, we want, multiple antennas and one radome kind of a thing and all this other thing. It seems cool, it seems great, but it's not the proper solution, right? If we can do something, we'll do it. But again, our goal is, again, to solve your problems. We're working on it every day. So give us your complaints, tell us what your problems are, and we'll try to solve them properly and responsibly. And you can see this echoed in our community, right? I mean, we have a very big fan base. People really stand behind us because they know that, you know, again, we're really working to try and help you guys and help the industry as a whole. So the community is really strong and we have a lot of support. Education, again, like I mentioned earlier, is something that's really important to us, right? So we try and, again, do things different than all our competitors and everybody else that's out in the field, right? So we have this new video series, if you guys are not familiar with it, on our YouTube channel called Inside Wireless, right? So it's these quick 2-3 minute videos that explain to you what's an antenna, right? What is gain? What's the side lobe these guys at RF Elements keep talking about? What's an actual side lobe, right? How do you read a polar plot? So many good things. If you're new to the industry, if you're a veteran of the industry, but you have new people working for you, these are great videos. Have your people tap into this information that we're putting out there. So a lot of really good information on our website and part of our education process. Ready? Yeah. So that's about RF Elements. We're gonna have our product manager come up and speak about signal coverage and some other aspects of our antennas.
So thanks for the handover. And as Tassos explained, in the light of helping our customers understand all the concepts behind the RF and the antennas as such, we'll have a short look into signal coverage, which every single one of you WISPs is dealing with on a daily basis. So the first message I want to put out is that the beamwidth does not equal the coverage area. I mean, oftentimes our customers have this understanding. They think that the beamwidth is coverage area. And even though they are closely or somewhat related to each other, they're definitely not the same thing. So the beamwidth is first and foremost an antenna parameter, right? And in WISP industry and many other industries, the -3 dB beamwidth and -6 dB beamwidth is considered a standard. And this standard has been accepted from other industries. And what these informations basically tell you is that within the solid angle defined by the -3 dB beamwidth, you get at least 50% of the maximum power that antenna radiates. And for the -6 dB beamwidth is at least 25% of the energy, maximum energy that the antenna radiates. So the beamwidth definitely defines the main lobe and is really closely tied to the maximum gain. The beamwidth is useful information when we're trying to align highly directional antennas. So obviously when the antenna has very high gain, it's also a very narrow beamwidth. And that is a good knowledge to have before, during, and even after we're aligning the point-to-point links, simply because even the smallest deviations from the proper alignment simply can cause the link to fail quite badly. Another place where the knowledge of the beam width is useful, that it gives us an information about whether the antenna might be better for point-to-point or point-to-multipoint applications. And while there is no strictly an antenna that's only for point-to-point or point-to-multipoint, the beam width is definitely a good information here, because as the gain grows, the beam width is simply shrinking. There is no way around it. That's the physics of the antennas. So in that sense, in this place, the beam width really tells us what an antenna might be suitable for, even though we still can use the point-to-point antenna even for a narrow distance sector, if that's the case, if the scenario requires it. In the textbooks about antennas, the minus 3 dB beamwidth is also used, or it's designated as a crossover point of two sectors, which means that the beamwidths or the beams of the coverage patterns of two sectors collocated at one tower should be crossing in that minus 3 dB point to provide a good coverage of a sector, right? And this is actually accepted from the cellular networks, where this might be true, but then again, not necessarily true everywhere, because this all depends on the rest of the hardware people are working with. Yeah? And there is so many parameters that play the role in deciding whether the 3 dB crossover point makes sense or not. So traditionally, the coverage is depicted something like you can see in the slide right now. So you take the beam width angle and put it on the map and plot this sort of pizza pie shape part of the circle and say, within this area, I do have a coverage and I do have a signal, and outside it, I do not. Yet when you put the CPE in a different position outside the supposed average coverage area, you still have a signal you can work with. And many of you might have also experienced that in your daily life, when you do plan the link somehow, and then when you deploy the whole thing, you still see the signals coming from other directions as well, which supposedly you were supposed to not see at all. So obviously something doesn't add up here. And this sort of illustration of the coverage area is really just a very rough approximation of what it is in reality. So in the coverage planning has a lot of components to it. So first and foremost, it is a continuous image of the signal power on a surface. And the components that come into this calculation are the parameters of the site. Yeah? There is the antenna, which has particular radiation pattern. And then there is the output power of the radio. The site has different height, and so on and so on. And then also on the side of the map, it also needs to have certain precision, yeah, so that we're able to plot these fields, the continuous image, correctly. A good example of the coverage area to imagine is when we point a flashlight on a surface. So the light is actually an electromagnetic wave as well, just like the 5 gigahertz RF signal, except at much higher frequencies. But because we can see it, it's easy to imagine and easy to understand. As we point the flashlight on a surface, we can see the coverage area very easily. But maybe at the RF waves, it's not so easy to visualize, simply because any electromagnetic waves outside the visible light spectrum are just not visible. But what we can do, though, is to actually pick a pseudocolor and assign the strongest signal strength this color. And as progressively the signal strength is fading, the color is thinning. Yeah, it's fading into transparency. So here is an example of what the coverage might look like with a 30 degree symmetrical horn. And there you can see the two dashed lines, which determine or tell where the 30 degree angle border is. So, and obviously the signal goes goes definitely beyond this line. So this is kind of what, you know, might be explaining your experience from the real world, where, you know, you might be wondering like why you're seeing this or that AP, since you were not supposed to, because the beamwidth only told you that you should not be seeing it. While this plot is the closest thing to the physical reality of what the coverage looks like, it's good for understanding, but for the practical use, it's really not so useful. So what we can do, we can use more than just one color. Yeah? So here's the same plot, but using five different colors. And it's definitely, because a human is a visual creature, it's definitely a lot easier to discern like where, for example, the signal has minus 70 dBm or minus 45 dBm. But eventually, the borders between these signal strengths are still very fuzzy, you know, because it's sort of like a mist. It's hard to see where is the border of which color. So what we can do even further, if on top of the knowledge of the output power of the access point and the gain of the CPE, if we also know the beamwidth, the bandwidth of the channel we're using, and we know we have the knowledge of what is the noise floor in a given area, we can do a plot like this one, which shows the MCS ISO surfaces. So each of these colors in this plot tells you what is the span of MCS rates you can expect the link working with. And this is really very useful in practice, you know, because it gives you an immediate visual information, depending obviously on the distance and position of your CPE, what you might expect. And the images up till now were static pictures at one frequency. So if we have the simulation data or the measurement data of the radiation patterns of antenna, we can plot these images at every frequency from the operating bandwidth of the antenna and animate them obviously to result into this kind of animation, which shows you how the coverage area changes with the frequency for mainstream patch array sector. So we can see at this point, you also might have some sort of aha moment, because you might have been scratching your head when you try to switch the channel to, you know, in hope of leveraging that cleaner bit of the spectrum, the situation might have even worsened, right? And that's like, well, how does this even work? And this is exactly why. So let me just remind you, this image is actually, or the animation is a result of real simulation with the real 3D radiation pattern data of this antenna. So the coverage fluctuates a lot. And this is something which is really undesirable to fixed wireless networks, simply because you can't rely on this coverage. It's not stable. And first and foremost, the customers like stability. Yes?
Why do you see such fluctuation? Is that because of the standard frequency and the bandwidth of the antenna that we're going on to the areas where the antenna isn't designed to operate at 6 gigahertz?
Well, this is the way the patch array sectors work. I mean, the physics of these antennas dictate that it's not easy to, you know, have the coverage stable. Yeah, it's simply based on that. Here we can see the same antenna or the animation for the same antenna, but for different polarization. And again, it's very frequency dependent, which introduces instability in your network and eventually results into unsatisfied customers and you running around and servicing your sites over and over. Here is how the coverage looks like for RF elements carrier class patch array sector. So it is definitely very stable compared to any other antenna in the WISP industry in the similar class. So while we did our best to actually stabilize the coverage as much as possible, again, because of the physics of these antennas, the investment into stabilizing this its pattern to a degree that it, you know, would really not move, it just is not economically viable. Yeah, nobody would buy that expensive antenna. And going further with our sectors, so horns are definitely a different game. Here is an example of the 60 degree asymmetrical horn. So you can see the coverage is a lot more stable than with your traditional sector. It still changes a little bit, but by far it's more stable than any sector antenna out there. And even more so with the symmetrical horns. Now, this is what makes symmetrical horns truly unique. You can see that the coverage doesn't almost change at all. It's like stone stable, except that little increase at the beginning of the spectrum. And this is exactly what is a huge advantage of the symmetrical sectors. Yeah, they offer you that stability, which is appreciated by your customers because you won't have so many calls from the angry customers with about changing or unstable internet, which again helps you to you know decrease your servicing runs. And if we have those 3D radiation pattern data for all the antennas in the whole bandwidth of their operation, we can also look at how the downtilt influences the coverage area. So from practice, I bet most of you know that with the mainstream patch array sectors, the coverage area is actually shrinking very rapidly with the downtilt. So anything beyond 5-6 degrees, the antenna is just not usable anymore. And this is actually only due to the shape of its radiation pattern, which is very narrow in the elevation plane. Simply that narrow radiation pattern in the elevation plane makes the coverage area to disappear very quickly as you're increasing the tilt. And that's again just the property of these antennas. Looking at the horns, on the other hand, our bracket allows you to change the down tilt from 0 up to 25 degrees. And as you can see, the coverage area is just progressively shrinking. Yeah. While the shape of the coverage area remains the same, you're just decreasing the distance, how far the antenna can see, which is actually quite, it's another perk of our antennas. It's another functionality advantage where you can dynamically actually respond to the changing customer base in a given sector and even improve your noise conditions. Because as you tilt the antenna more, given that you provide the service to all your customers they need, you know, as you're tilting the antenna, it sees less and less noise coming from the outside, actually even in front of it. And the similar is valid for our symmetrical sectors. So because of the symmetrical radiation pattern, the progression of the shrinking of the coverage area is actually even more smooth, yeah, than with the asymmetrical ones. But similarly, it again leaves you with the added functionality of dynamically being able to adjust to the changing customer base and being able to suppress the noise in your network even more. So now I want to tell you something a little bit about the antenna parameters, because obviously every wireless network can be made or broken depending on how good or not good an antennas you're using might be or not. So there's many parameters antennas have, and it only depends on the given application which ones are important or not. For example, in the cellular networks, it doesn't matter that the antenna in your phone has a very high VSWR, simply because the link budget still adds up and it works pretty well. So it's all really dependent on the application where an antenna is used. So let's have a look which parameters are important for WISP networks. So first is the gain. I mean, if the higher the gain, the stronger the signal. Makes perfect sense. Very easy to do, but there's a catch. Since there is a limit on how much EIRP you can radiate, it's only a question of time before the air is saturated with power. And because most of the WISPs use very similar hardware, we've already reached this tipping point. So increasing the gain is really not non-viable way of making your networks work better. Then we can have more bandwidth, right? And we can use more polarizations. And the star is similar with these two parameters, right? It's only a question of time before the spectrum gets congested with those many devices being deployed all the time without any regulation. That's just how it is in the free bands. It's a fair game. Anybody can do what they want. And because of that, the increasing bandwidth and polarization has a tipping point, which is also already reached for the most part. Then there is the front-to-back ratio or side lobe level. And customers or WISPs often assign great importance to these parameters because they might think that having good front-to-back ratio means the antenna has no side lobes. Well, unfortunately, that's not true. So what the WISPs should truly care about is actually beam efficiency. So defining the main lobe by the first null, and taking the energy which the antenna radiates in the main lobe and dividing it by the total energy the antenna radiates, we get beam efficiency. So what it basically tells us is how much energy the antenna radiates, like what portion of the energy the antenna radiates is contained in the main lobe. Or in other words, it's a good measure of side lobes. So obviously the higher the beam efficiency, the less side lobes an antenna has. So if the beam efficiency is 70%, then 70% of the energy antenna radiates goes into the main lobe and 30% anywhere else. And while the beam efficiency is defined at a single frequency and at a single polarization in the textbooks about antennas, it totally makes sense to average the beam efficiency over the whole bandwidth an antenna operates, simply because it gives it a lot more weight. It gives it a lot more reliability. The information is a lot more robust if we average it over the whole bandwidth an antenna operates. And not only that, but also averaging it over the both polarizations. And again, that's just an added weight to this kind of information. So because the front-to-back ratio and the side lobe level only gives us information about one single side lobe, they're not so important, really. Instead, the beam efficiency considers the whole 3D radiation pattern, meaning it considers all the side lobes that are there. So that's the first important point why the beam efficiency is the most complete measure of the side lobe level performance antennas have. The second reason is that, as shown in the previous slide, is that it's averaged over the whole frequency bandwidth of operation, which gives it a lot more weight in terms of the stability of this parameter. So let's have a look at how some of the antennas in the WISP industry perform in terms of the beam efficiency. So the patch array sectors have a lot of side lobes and a lot of frequency dependent side lobes. So that's why their beam efficiency is rather low, even with our sector. I mean, we did our best to suppress the side lobes as much as we could, but the physics of these antennas dictate that you can't really get very high with the beam efficiency of these antennas. And not all the antennas are the same. So having a horn doesn't mean that you automatically have high beam efficiency. And there's, at least with our antennas, we definitely still put considerable effort into optimizing their performance so that their beam efficiency is reaching well above 90%. Yeah, so 90%, more than 90% of the energy our horns radiate go into the main lobe. An ultra horn has 99% beam efficiency. That's really unique in terms of the beam efficiency performance in the WISP industry. So 99% of the energy the ultra horn radiates goes into the main lobe. Yeah, only 1% goes somewhere else. So with this short technical intermission, I hand over the presentation back to Tassos. Thank you.
Thank you. So what do you think about that? Beam efficiency. We talked about earlier, creating a whole new vocabulary for this industry and really trying to teach you guys what to really look for and really to challenge, right? Maybe we're not your favorite vendor. That's fine. You know, whoever it is, challenge them to do better, because we all need it. So beam efficiency, I think, is something you're going to start hearing about in the future.
Yeah, I just forgot to add one more thing. So from now on, we're adding the beam efficiency into all our data sheets, because it's useful information for the user. So we're doing it. And the same goes for the 3D radiation patterns of all our antennas, which are now included in our data sheets.
Cool. All right, so now we'll go on to new products, and this is probably the most exciting part for, you know, most people when they come to vendor presentations. So what we're really doing at this point is we're kind of just adding to our existing product line, adding some additional functionality and stuff like that. So one of those new products now is the carrier class version of the asymmetrical horn, right? So, you know, we have a TwistPort adapter that you can put in the TwistPort version and make it essentially connectorized if you wish. But for a lot of WISPs, they may already be hard set on the fact that the radio system they use is connectorized. So they don't want to have a TwistPort horn and then a connectorized TwistPort adapter. So it just makes it a lot easier. If you know you're using a radio system that requires LMR cable, then you'd want to buy the carrier class version of the asymmetrical horns. Again, with the asymmetrical horns carrier class, you get all the same functionality of the first version. If you're already using our TwistPort version of the asymmetrical horns, all the frequency stability, all the great noise rejection, all the great qualities of that product, it's identical in our carrier class version. So carrier class isn't to say it's carrier class and it's a much better quality or something like that. It's just a different brand for the connectorized version of our antennas. So in the carrier class asymmetrical horn, again, you still get the balanced vertical and horizontal beam patterns, where you get very good coverage in both polarities at the same angles. And again, they're all made with the same hardware as the previous version, the TwistPort version that you may already be familiar with, right? So all aluminum, stainless steel, high quality materials used within all of our builds and all of our products. The only difference between the TwistPort and the carrier class version, which might be important for you guys, is there's actually four versions now. So for those of you who've used the asymmetrical 30 degree, you may know that we have that beam switch functionality where you can actually turn the antenna 90 degrees and change the beam pattern. So instead of it being 30 degrees wide, it can be 20 degrees wide. You can't do that functionality with the asymmetrical carrier class because of the connectors. So if you were to rotate it 90 degrees, the connectors would come out the side of the antenna. So we have two individual SKUs. So basically you're picking either 20 degrees wide, 30 degrees wide, 60 degrees wide, or 90 degrees wide at the time of purchase. Okay, and they're available now, so they should, I don't know if they're already on the shelves or on their way, but they're shipping at the moment. Twin horn bracket. So this is a kind of user feedback from you guys, right? So people are wanting to do 4x4 these days and some other unique things with their radios. So in February, we should have available the twin horn bracket. So again, it's really simple to use and to be able to align two horn antennas on the same exact azimuth, right? So again, how you use it is kind of up to you, but perhaps you're using EPMP 3000 and you want to do 4x4 with horns. So the twin horn bracket will allow you to take two 30 degree horns, two 90 degree horns, two 60, whatever version of the symmetrical horns you want, whatever beam angle you're trying to go for, mount it to the bracket and ensure that they're facing the same azimuth. So therefore, you're delivering four polarizations to the same coverage area. And you still get all the abilities to adjust azimuth and elevation. Again, it supports at the moment the EPMP 3000 and the Mimosa A5C for 4x4 operation. And you could use either the carrier class version, or again, you could use the TwistPort version with the SMA adapters. Does somebody have a question? I believe it's 20 degrees. Yeah, it's 20 degrees of mechanical up and down tilt in the bracket. This is kind of just a follow-up. So it's kind of a new adapter. It's been out for a while, but we have the TwistPort adapter EPMP for the EPMP 3000 and 1000 line from Cambium Networks. So if we look at the connectivity map here, we kind of break it down to, for Cambium, which antenna product is better suited for which radio product. So if we look at the TwistPort version of our horn antennas, the EPMP 3000 Lite, the 300 CSM, which is this customer side radio, the EPMP 2000, there's multiple variants of that, and the EPMP 1000 antenna system are suited for our TwistPort system. If you're using the larger radios like the 450, right, the 450 SM, the 550, 670, and even the PTP 700, these are all supported through our carrier class version of our antennas, which basically give you the end connectors for connectivity. The next new product we have is a TwistPort adapter for the C5X from Mimosa. So the C5X is Mimosa's waveguide fed radio system that they launched about a year ago. So we have a new TwistPort adapter for that, which simply just converts their waveguide into our waveguide and makes it compatible with all of our TwistPort enabled antennas. There is a pretty unique feature because people that use Mimosa know that they usually do the slant 45, right? So we actually have a mechanism so you can either have it in HV mode if you want it for horizontal and vertical, or you can twist it and then put it in and still operate in slant 45. So you have the ability to run them in both, however you want to do it through the adapter. We also have this little cheat, right, for TwistPort adapters, because we're often asked, well, what TwistPort adapter do I use for what radio? This stuff could be found on our website. So we break it down now by manufacturer. So if you look at Ubiquiti Networks at the top, we have the PATH adapter, which supports all the air fibers, fives, and prism radios, and now the new LTU as well. We have the TwistPort adapter ISO for all those round radio form factors from Ubiquiti, right? Like the ISO station and the prism station. That's basically, again, converting their waveguide interface into our standard. And then we have, again, support for the Rocket M5, Rocket AC lights, some of their legacy radios as well. And we do the same thing for Cambium, Mimosa, and so forth. So if you're using a radio system and you haven't used our antennas yet and you're curious, you can look at our cheat sheet here and find the radio you want to use, and it kind of points you in the direction of which TwistPort adapter you need for your radio platform. Another new product is a Station Box Alu-Mini, right? So this is really a compact enclosure. It's kind of an integration platform for the IoT world, right? So I know as WISPs, you know, we're always doing interesting things and trying to create new products as well and new services. So if you have any IoT or any sort of outdoor project with wireless, it's just a really cool box that allows you to put, again, you know, your design board or whatever you want inside of it, and just gives you a really cool IP67 rated outdoor box for just some special projects that you may have. A really unique thing about it, and it's really cool, is the actual mount for it, right? So it's a pretty cool design where the box just slides in and then locks into place. So it's pretty cool. It could be wall mounted or pole mounted as well, as we see here. So again, we'll have all these products at our booth, so you can come see them and we can talk about them in more detail if you're interested. So, you know, part of what I said earlier is like we really try and do things different, right? So there are some products that we feel should just be open for the public, right? So we're starting to do some different things. We've heard for the EPMP 3000 Lite, a lot of users out there were wanting to use them with some other manufacturers' antennas, like Ubiquiti's antennas or our carrier class sector or what have you. So we've actually created a printable 3D printable bracket that you attach to it to give you those little tabs, that way they can slide in and go onto the antennas of your choice, right? So now, again, if you want to use somebody else's antenna with the EPMP 3000, you can go to our website, download the file, and 3D print as many brackets as you want for free. So we felt that it's not worth actually manufacturing and selling them. We'll just give it away to everybody. So the design files can be found on our website. The same thing goes for the path adapter for LTU, right? So for those of you who use Ubiquiti and are familiar with the platform, the AirFiber 5 HD was called LTU for a while, right? And the form factor was supposed to stay the same for their new Rocket R LTU radio. Well, they changed some of the heat sinks in the back, right? So the adapter that we had made for our TwistPort adapter for the AirFiber to interface with that adapter changed slightly. You have to kind of modify it, right? So we'll be changing that in the future shipments of our products. So it'll be fully compatible with now the LTU, the air fibers, and the Prism. But if you want to do it now, you can go to our form or our website, and you can download the 3D file and just print the adapter yourself. So it makes it pretty quick. We actually have some in our booth. So if you want, we can give you some samples now to take back if you need it and stuff like that. But again, some of this stuff, man, is just, it should be public domain, right? So that's what we're trying to do out there and put out there. So something new from us that we're trying to make a difference. Stainless steel hardware still, right? So this is, again, one of the biggest issues we have with, you know, the user base is, you know, why do you use stainless steel, right? Why aren't you using galvanized like everybody else, right? And we just feel that stainless steel is superior. However, it has some, you know, bad points or things you really need to know about, right? So again, the user base didn't know this in the early days. We made the assumption that people understood that stainless steel galls, right? It cold fuses to itself, right? It's a property of stainless, unfortunately. So you have to use anti-seize lubricant. That's the only caveat to that, right? So if you're new to our product and you're thinking about using it, you have to use anti-seize on the stainless steel bolts, and you'll guarantee that the bolts won't rust. And when you go up there, because you have to realign it after 4 years or something like that, it'll be much better than galvanized and rust. Ecological packing, right? So we're trying to do something for the environment as well. We use recycled cardboard and stuff like that, less styrofoam, less packing material and stuff. So trying to make a difference there as well. I really can't tell you how important it is for, you know, users to get involved in kind of the online community, right? I mean, there's a lot out there on our forums. I know a lot of people aren't, they're anti-Facebook or what have you, but there's really a lot of good information out there. I mean, you don't necessarily have to get involved and put yourself out there, right? But there's a lot of WISPs, a lot of people like yourselves dealing with a lot of the problems that you're dealing with, and they're going out there and they're solving those problems online, right? So it's really important to kind of plug into that system, be part of that ecosystem, if anything, just to troll it, right? Just to see what people are doing to help you solve your problem. So a lot of information is being put out there. A lot of information is on our YouTube channel and our website, right? Great resource, you know. A lot of the questions that you may have are probably already answered either on our forum, on our website, or on our YouTube channel, right? So the information's there. You just need to go look for it a little bit, right? So again, joining our online community will bring great benefits, I think, to all of you.